questions from last time.
Yes, sir. The question about functional derivative.
Yes.
So when the functional is like pi y squared d for y integration.
Yes.
So we end up with the functional derivative like 2 pi of x.
Yes.
So functional derivative is like here, and it also depends on the function.
Yes.
Around that point where we are trying to derivative like x.
That's right, yes.
It also tells that we are calculating the functional derivative at what value of phi.
Well, so that, yes. So it depends also delta delta phi x. Right. It will of course depend on the choice of phi, right? Because the derivative, think of this as a variable, right? The derivative depends on the value of the variable, right? If you change your phi, that's like changing the variable itself. Okay, that's the value of the variable. So the derivative of a function should depend on the value of the variable, right? That's like the function phi itself. Okay. Then the derivative should depend on, suppose you have a delta delta xi, right? Xi are the variables. It will depend on the index I. Right? Which variable you are differentiating on with respect to? That's this x. Right? Defined x's, if you think in a discrete form, right, they are the i's. Right? So yes, the functional derivative depends on, first of all, which function you are differentiating. Right? Then the value of the phi itself, right, the function phi, right, and the argument, okay, which means that which variable you are differentiating it with respect to. This class, it depends on all of these. Yes.
In the propagator, we got in the denominator like this ku square minus k square minus n square.
That's right.
And we said that it has a similarity at point k0 is equal to
square root of k square
plus n square. But there could be points also k square is equal to k0 square minus n square.
Yeah, so there's the same singularity, right? It depends on what integral you perform first, so k0 square minus k square minus m square equal to 0, right? This is where the singularity is, right? So you can think of this, if you do the k0 integral first, then you will see this as a k0 at square root of k square plus m square. If you do the kx integral first, right, you will see it in the other way, right? But it's the same singularity. Then when this vanishes, the result blows up, the integral blows up. Right? And then you take into account, take care of this by using this I epsilon prescription.
Okay. Even in that case also this m square
replaced by so also replace m square by m square minus I epsilon. Right? It basically removes all the singularities, right? And if you take the k integrals along the real axis, then that removes everything. Right? Or you rotate the k0 integration contour. That instead of going along the real axis, you tilt it. Okay, that does the same job.
So the tilting of time axis, can we call it also analytic continuation?
It is like an analytic continuation, yes.
Okay. In the propagator, we had k0 square minus k square minus m square. Then we replaced it by for the imaginary time, we took k0 square into 1 by 1 minus I epsilon.
That's it, yes.
And for k square and m square, we multiplied it by 1 minus
yes.
I epsilon. So that comes from the action actually. So in action, if we replace the time by the imaginary time, then we get those factors.
Exactly.
So how exactly this thing comes in the k spaces? So in k spaces, how do these things come actually?
Yeah. So the point is that in the time, so what you are supposed to do is that you are supposed to fill the time axis like this. So now you think of this variable, say there is still a real variable along this line, right? Call this tau. Okay. That is a real integral. Okay. So all the Fourier transform, etc. that you are taking with respect to this variable tau. Okay. But now, but this doesn't give the answer that you want. Right? The answer that you want is for this time. Okay. Maybe I should do it this way. So we okay, let's do it this way. So the action becomes, so once you write t as tau, t was tau times 1 minus I epsilon, right? 1 minus I epsilon. So you get 1 minus I epsilon dt, and then you have 1 over 1 minus, sorry, d tau, 1 minus I epsilon square d phi del phi delta 1 square minus 1 minus phi square, phi square plus m square phi square. This is not there, this will become come after you have multiplied, right? So now all the Fourier transforms are taken with respect to tau variable, because this is a real variable, right? And then whatever I epsilon you have is what you have to take this into account, right? So k0, you think of this as a Fourier transform variable of tau.
Okay.
Okay, because that's real, right? So with that understanding, right, this 1 minus 1 over 1 minus I epsilon automatically becomes part of the action. That clear? Because there is a k0 square coming down from here, which will be now divided by 1 minus I epsilon. Are there other questions? Okay, so let me just briefly remind you of all the results that we had, because it will be useful today. So we introduce this function zj. The general definition of this was that this is integral d phi to the power I s of phi plus I integral d 4x dx phi x and the reason for introducing this function is that if we try to calculate say Green's function gx1 to xn, which is integral d phi the I is of phi of x1 phi of xn, this we saw can be written as 1 over z0 times minus I delta delta g of x1 when you take the derivatives, you bring down essentially from here the factors of phi. Okay, that's how you prove this identity. So
there will be also one z by g.
One?
In the definition of g, there will be also one by
yes.
z.
Yes, thank you. Integral d phi. Then we calculated the free result, the free field theory. So, z free of j, okay. This you saw explicitly that there is some normalization and then exponential of minus half and delta xy was minus I okay, I just took a minus sign outside to write it as minus sign. Yeah, there we are written as I times 1 over minus k square minus m square plus I epsilon. Okay, so this is what we had derived last time. Is this okay? Now, one thing we see from here already, that delta xy, of course, is a function of x minus y, which is not a surprise, but it's also symmetric under xy exchange. Right, under xy exchange, this changes sign, okay, But that can be compensated for by changing the integration variable from k to minus k. Okay, so delta xy is delta, this is the same as delta yx. And then using this, we worked out one example, two-point function, gx1, x2. Okay, which is given here, so you have to differentiate twice. And the way we did it is that we use the form, is this form for j, for z. The first delta delta j brought down a factor of delta times j. Okay. Then the second delta delta j had to act on the other j, because without that, ultimately when you said j equal to 0, that term will vanish. Okay. So you saw that this is delta x1 x2. Okay. So basically the minus sign here got cancelled against minus I squared, because there are two factors of minus I coming there. Okay, that took up care of the minus sign, and the half that came here cancelled against the fact that we have two different derivatives. Like the first delta delta j could either act on this or this. One gave half delta xy, the other one gave half delta yx, and then using symmetry we got delta xy. So is this point clear? Okay. So today let's go ahead and try to do the next one. Okay. Which is gx1, x2, x3, x4, and then we'll do the most general one. So gx1, x2, x3, x4. So this is 1 over z0 times minus I delta delta j x1 times this exponent let me write this as n and this in fact is now becomes just 1 because z0 is just n that's it right z we are phi so let me write phi also because we will be considering a general case later. So these are all phi Green's functions here. Okay, and then this exponent. But now let's do one thing. We'll just expand it out as a power series. Okay. So you get minus half to the power n, and then integral d4x d4y gxy delta x gx gy equal delta xy to the power n. And there is a 1 over n factor there. Okay, we are just expanding the exponential in power series. Is this clear? Okay. Now the reason that we have done this is because eventually you have to set j equal to 0. Right? So most of the terms in the power series will eventually go away. Okay, because you will set j equal to 0. Okay. So which term here will contribute to this amplitude? You have any guess? Eventually you have to set j equal to 0. So at j equal to 0. Which term will contribute? N equal to 2. Does everybody agree with that? See, n equal to 0 term of course is constant, right? It will not give any derivative. N equal to 2 term, n equal to 1 term has two factors of j, right? So 4 derivatives of j are not going to give anything non-zero. N equal to 2 term has 4 factors of j. So that has a chance of being non-zero. N equal to 3 onwards will have more factors of j. So eventually when you say j equal to 0, they will go away. Okay. So this then is 1 over 2 factorial times 1 fourth n equal to 2, and then we have integral d4x d4y delta xy g of y, and integral, let me call this d4 x prime d4 y prime. Equal to 0, or you can replace it by this, because eventually you have to set j equal to 0. Now, you see that eventually you have to differentiate this j with respect to these four j's. Okay. This x will eventually be identified to either x1, x2, x3 or x4, okay, because they are delta functions. This y will also be identified to one of these xi's. Okay. Similarly, these two, right? So the general structure is clear. Okay. The general structure will be delta, there will be term like delta x1, x2. Delta x2, x3, sorry, x3, x4, or delta x1, x3, delta x2, x4, or delta x1, x4, delta x2, x3. Okay, these are the four possible, three possible terms. We have coefficients c1, c2, c3, okay, which you have to determine. How many times a term like this can appear, for example, right? That will determine the coefficient c1. Is that clear? Now, it's not hard to see that c1, c2 and c3 should be all equal. That's by symmetry, right? This was perfectly symmetric in x1, x2, x3, x4. Right, we could have exchanged any of them because the derivatives, of course, commute. So this is, there is full symmetry under the permutations of x1, x2, x3, x4. So we expect that this should be some constant c times delta x1, x2, delta x3, x4 plus delta x1, x3, delta x2, x4. Plus delta x1, x4, delta x2, x3. Okay, and now we have to determine what c is. So here, in fact, there is a shortcut way of determining what c is. So to see this, first, let's check. Okay, so C. So how will you determine C? C has that 1/8 factor outside, right? 1/2 times 1/4. This factor over here. Then it should be determined by that 1/8 times total number of terms. That you could possibly get by differentiating. Okay. But you have to divide this by 3. Why 3? Because there are 3 different kinds of terms. Right? So your total number of terms is something, right? Each term will come that divided by 3 times. Is that part clear? Yes. So what we'll do is that we'll just count. We have taken out this factor already, 1/8. Now, we'll count that if we just apply this on this, how many terms we can get. without worrying about whether it's what the arguments of the deltas are. So that gives a total number of terms. That's what I mean by total number of terms. Okay. So that total number of terms, some of them are of this kind. Some of them are of this kind. Some of them are of this kind, right? By symmetry argument, we know that the numbers are all equal. Okay. So if we know the total number of terms, right, and if we divide it by the number of different kinds of terms that there are, you should get the number of times each term appears. Is that clear? Right. Suppose I assume that this term appears n times, right? This appears n times and this appears n times. Then what is the total number of terms? 3n, right? So 3n should be equal to the total number of terms. So you just divide it by 3 and we get the coefficient of each term. So that's the logic. Okay. So let's see how many ways you can get total, what total number of terms you can have, which is not very easy, difficult to determine. Okay. Take this first derivative over here, right? It can act on any of these 4 j's, right? So that gives you 4. Once you have done that, then you take the second one. Okay. Now there are 3 j's left over. It can act on any of those 3 j's, right? So that gives you 3. And then 2 times 1. So this is 1/8. Times 24 over 3 is 1. Is that clear? Okay. So we'll now do this for the general case. Okay, and we'll try to use the same logic to determine what the result should be in the general case. So basically what we learn is that the result for gx1, x2, x3, x4 is just delta x1, x2, delta x3, x4 plus delta x1, x3, delta x2, x4 plus delta x1, x4, delta x2, x3, right? C is just 1.
It's like how many permutations of x1 to x4 you are making, right?
Roughly, yes, that's right, right? Because you have 4 of these, right? And you have to act on 4 of these, right? You have to pair, basically you have to pair these 4 with these 4, right? Because each of these could act on any of those j's, 4 j's, right?
If we come from here actually, like this is the structure we know of the terms actually. How many complex combinations can you make? I mean, like, if you have already written the answer like this.
Yes.
Then you can ask like how many possible combinations of this could have arisen.
Yes, that also is one way of doing it, right? But then you have to make sure that you, for example, if you want to calculate this directly, right? You have to count only those which are of this form. Right, you have to keep track of which term gives what, right? Whereas the way I counted, I didn't care about whether the when you take the derivative, right, whether it's of this kind, or this kind, right? So you could have done it that way also, right? Then you don't divide by 3, right? But you ask how many of these terms will have that form, delta x1, x2, delta x3, x4, right? Not all of these will have that form. For example, if x4 acts on this, and if x3 acts on this one, that clearly doesn't have the first form, right? Because x4 and x3 should act on the same delta. Okay, so you can do that counting that way also. Right? It's a little more complicated, but it's certainly doable. Okay, after all, the answer is unique, right? There are many different ways of getting to the answer. Is this okay?
So generally we will also have this minus I factor.
Yes. Here it cancels, we'll see that every time it will cancel.
It is I think 1 in this case.
Yes, minus I to the 4 is 1. Right? There is also minus 1 to the n. Right? These factors will always cancel because you'll always get minus I to the power 2n.
Okay.
And minus 1 to the n, right, which will give 1. Right? It's a little more non-trivial to check that this half to the n and the others combined to also cancel. Right? But a minus signs will always clearly cancel, like minus 1 to the n and minus I to the n.
Actually, only the even point correlation functions are.
Yes, only the even point correlation functions will be non zero. The odd point correlation functions will clearly be zero, right? If you have 3 different j's, Right? There's no term here which has three j's. Because only the even point correlation functions will be non-zero. Any other question?
So I didn't get that logic, that minus I to the power 2n.
Yes. Okay. Well, we are going to do now. So far you have done only 4, right? Let's do the case where we have 2n. Okay, then it will become clear. So G x1 to x2n. This is what you want to calculate, right? So we have n over z0, which is 1. Okay, so minus I delta delta g of x1 to minus I delta delta g of x2n of that object, that expansion, n equal to 0 to infinity minus half to the power n, 1 over n factorial, and then integral d4x d4y delta xy gx gy to the power n. Okay, this is what you want to calculate, and at the end you have to set j equal to 0. Okay? So now let's first see which term will contribute from here.
N equal to 2n.
That is the n. Direct term. Well, maybe I should have written it as M. Okay, let me write it as M. So only the M equal to N term will contribute. Is that clear? Because you need 2N J's. So when you said M equal to N, okay, that x now we work out the factor. We get minus I to the power 4. There are 2n factors. Right? 2n factors of minus I. Times minus 1 to the power n. Times 1 over 2 to the n. 1 over n factors. Times some constant which you have to determine, and then you have, let's write one term, delta x1 x2 delta x3 x4 up to delta x2n minus 1 x2n plus number of inequivalent permutations. So what do you mean by inequivalent permutations? Equivalent permutation is x1, x2, xn is a certain permutation of x1, x2 up to x2n, right? But that doesn't change the term. Right? It remains the term the same. So it's not counted as an inequivalent permutation. Right? If you exchange x1 with x3 and x2 with x4, that again doesn't do anything, right? Because x1 with x3 and x2 with x4 exchange will again just exchange these two factors. So you don't count those as inequivalent. Okay. You count only those permutations which actually change the term. Okay, so you write down all possible terms which are actually different from each other. Okay. So the general structure should be this. And the coefficient should be the same for each of these. Okay. Simply because to begin with, there is full symmetry between x1, x2 up to xn, right? So the result that you get better be invariant under the full permutation of x1, x2 up to x2n. Right? It's just that you are not adding all the possible permutations because some of them are actually equivalent, right? Okay, that's why you are basically some permutations which will give the same result We want to dump that into a coefficient of this. That's why the C is coming in. The permutation which will give the same result will come in C.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, why 2n?
2n minus 1 to n? Because here that goes up to 2n, right? X 2n, so there are 2n or 2n j's. The n is raised to nth power, but there are 2n j's altogether. Right? And those 2n j's have to match up with these 2n delta little j's. Is this clear? So now we have to determine C. Okay. So we'll determine it again by the same trick. C is the total number of terms. Here in this derivative, divided by the total number of terms which are inside this bracket. That is C. Right? Because when you do these derivatives, you will get a certain set of terms. Right? All you are doing is that those set of terms you are now grouping, right, identical terms together and extracting out this coefficient C. Right? So if you know the total number of terms that you will get from this derivative and divide by the total number of terms that, that are inside this sum, that's what C is. Is that clear? So C is total number of terms. Divided by the number of terms inside the square bracket. Okay? Which will be the number of equivalent terms that you can get. That's the number of terms inside the two square bracket. So total number of terms is not hard to determine. So what is the total number of terms? 2n factorial, right? The 2n things being applied on 2n j's, right? Anything can apply on any j, right? So the first one can act in 2n ways, second one can act in 2n minus 1 ways, and so on. So the total number of terms is 2n factorial. So, determine the number of terms inside the square bracket. Let's take this list x1, x2 up to xn and start with x1. Now, x1 has to pair with something. Right? There should be at least one term in any term, right? X1 is paired with something. Right? But that something can be chosen in 2n minus 1 ways. Is that clear? So, that first factor we get is 2n minus 1. So for every choice of this, right, we are left with 2n minus 2 elements in the list, right, which is still up to pair. Now pick the lowest one of that list. Right? If you have chosen x1 and x2, then pick x3. If you have chosen x1 and x3, pick x2. Okay, x2 is the lowest one in the list. This can be paired with anything else in that list. Okay? So how many such terms are there? 2n minus 3, right? Because 2n minus 2 have already gone, right? 2n minus 2 are left, of which you have picked the lowest one. So 2n minus 3 terms are left. You can pair, right? So that gives you 2n minus 3. Okay, and then you repeat this, right? So now 4 are gone. You again pick the lowest one in that list and pair it in all possible ways with everything else. So that gives you 2n minus 5 and so on. So now let's try to expand it out. So you get 2n times 2n minus 1, 2n minus 2 up to 1 divided by 2n minus 1, 2n minus 3 up to 1. Okay. So you see that basically what happens is the odd terms get cancelled. These get cancelled and there is 2n minus 3 here, which gets cancelled against here. So denominator is gone completely. Right? In the numerator, you have 2n times 2n minus 2 times 2n minus 4 and so on. Right? From each of those, you can factor out 2. Because each are even, right? So how many such factors will there be?
N
factors, right? So you get 2 to the n times n factorial.
But x1 and x2 themselves can be interchanged, so shouldn't there be a denominator?
No, x1 and x2, if you interchange, that's not inequivalent, no? So you have to, in the denominator, you have to divide. If you have x1 and x2 exchange, right, that will count as the same term, right? So we are counting now how many equivalent things are there in the square bracket, right? So we will not count those as independent, right? Otherwise, you will put an additional factor of 2 in the denominator, right? But then you have to add x1, x2 plus x2, x1, right? But that is the same term, so you don't want to write that, right? You just really want to count the inequivalent ones. Is this okay?
Sir,
yes?
Numerator contains all the inequivalent and plus equivalent.
Yes, numerator contains everything, right? And now you are saying that if some of that everything, right, all the terms, we now group together into inequivalent terms times some coefficient, right? Each will be appearing certain number of times, and by symmetry, the number of times a given term will appear will be the same. Doesn't matter which term you are looking at, right? That's why I wrote it as C times this. And now the idea is that if you take C times this, right, then number of terms here times C should be equal to total number of terms that we started with. Right? That's how we are calculating our C. Okay. So this gives C is 2 to the n times n factorial, and so this is just 1. Right? Minus 1 to the I to the 2n times minus 1 to the n is 1. Right? And then 1 over 2 to the n times n factorial times this is 1. So you just get this, all possible ways of writing this without any further coefficient. Is this point clear? Okay, so this is what is called the Higgs theorem and free field theory. Okay, the way to calculate n point Green's function, just as products of two point Green's functions. Now, the fact that the combinatorial factors all cancel is not an accident. Basically, it reflects the fact that if you have n terms like this, right, then there is an exchange between gx and gy, right? For every time one derivative acts on this and another one acts on this, there is also another term where they get exchanged. Right? That basically gets rid of the factor of 2, which is in the denominator. Right? For every factor like this, right, there will always be a factor of 2, right, because you can exchange which j it acts on. And this m factorial is gotten rid of simply by using the fact that if you have that given this m terms here over here, right, which are all symmetric, right, given any particular contribution, right, there should be m factorial different contributions where you have just exchanged the role of these. Right? Whether a particular derivative, right, acted on this or second one or the third one, it makes no difference, right, as long as the organization is the same. Yeah, so that takes care of the m factorial, and that's the reason why you are getting 1 for the number of equivalent permutations. Is this clear? Okay. But this is important to remember that for free field theory, combinatorial factors are all trivial, okay, because you are going to use it for interacting field theory. So this is often encoded in what is called Feynman rules, okay, which you have seen in the UFT 1 course. Okay, but this is just rederivation of the Feynman rules in this language. So, in Feynman rule, we take this we denote a propagator delta xy by just a line. Okay, the x and y written on the two ends. Okay, this is a diagrammatic representation of the Feynman rule. And for every phi that we had in the original Green's function, right, for every delta delta jx that we have here, which are basically in one front corresponding to phi's whose correlation functions are calculated. For every one of these, we must have a corresponding coordinate at the two ends. Okay, that's the rule. Okay, so when you draw Feynman diagrams, you have to make sure that none of the ends are actually hanging free. Okay, none of the ends are free index. It should be one of the delta delta j's which have acted on the correlation function. Right? Because see, free index means what? That there is a jx hanging around there, right? But at the end you are going to set a j equal to 0. Right? So unless the j has been differentiated, right, that it doesn't contribute to the result. Right? So for every x and y, for every n, okay, there must be a corresponding x that you that is here. Is that part clear? And then the idea is that given these rules for calculating any n-point Green's function, you draw all possible Feynman diagrams and add their contribution. Okay, so for example, in this language, if you try to calculate gx1, x2, x3, x4, we have four delta delta j's, right? So x1, x2, x3, and x4. Each of them must get attached, must correspond to end of some propagator. Right? Because delta delta j either has to act on some delta, right? Some j, otherwise it will give you 0. So one contribution is this one, x1, x2, x3, x4. Okay, delta delta j, x1 and delta delta j, x2 has acted on the same term in the exponent, and delta delta j, x3 and delta delta j, x4 has acted on the other term. There we have x1, x3, x2, x4. And then you have x1, x4, x2, x3. These are the inequivalent Feynman diagrams you can draw for this. And you can check that it's not possible to draw any other diagram with these rules, that every delta delta jx, delta delta jxi should correspond to end of some propagator, and there should be no propagator whose ends are not one of these delta delta jx. Is this point clear? Okay, so this Feynman diagram gives a contribution delta x1 x2 times delta x3 x4. This one gives delta x1 x3 delta x2 x4, and this one gives delta x1 x4 delta x2 x3. And the same story holds for 2n external lines. Right? You can see now in this language that if there are odd number of external lines, odd number of delta delta jxi, right, then it's not possible to draw a Feynman diagram, right, for that process. Right? Because each propagator has two ends. Right? Both ends must correspond to some delta delta jx. Okay? So with odd number you cannot get a Feynman diagram, and that's what shows that the odd point Green's functions also vanish. Their questions. So now we are going to go to interacting theory, and you will see that the interacting theory Feynman rules basically can be all read out from the free theory Feynman rules. So let's consider the what is called phi 4 theory. The case of phi Okay, lambda is a constant, and we'll do a perturbation expansion assuming the lambda is small. Okay, this four factor in the denominator is just normalization constant that we have included. Okay, I could have also absorbed it inside lambda, but this will be convenient to have one over four factor. Okay, so this is the theory that you want to analyze. Is this clear? Now let's try to calculate Zj. Okay, this time it's not free anymore. So this will be integral d phi I'll write this as I is free of phi. Plus I integral d4x g of x phi of x minus I lambda over 4 factorial because okay, so I wrote the action as a sum of a free field theory action and then interacting. And now we want to do a perturbation expansion in lambda. So to do that, you might as well do the expansion now. Okay. So I'll write this as sum over n equal to 0 to infinity. This I can write okay, now let's see what we have done. So these factors are of course constant, right? I can take them out of the integral. Okay. We have seen earlier that inserting a phi in this is like minus I delta j. Right? Because if you apply minus I delta j of x on z free, which is here, okay, it will bring down a phi. But here you want to bring down four phi's. Phi of x is a differentiate minus I delta j x 4 times. Okay. Then you integrate over d4x, okay, which is of course there. Okay. But this operation, okay, now that it doesn't depend on phi, right, you have to written as a derivative. Okay. This can be now pulled out of the integral. Is that point clear? See delta, so this is an integral over d phi of some function of phi and g. delta delta g, let's say, of some function of phi and g, or some function of phi and g, right? Integral is over phi, so I can just pull the delta delta g outside this integral, right? I can first do the integral, then differentiate. Okay? This is what, in fact, we use to show that, argue that in the free field theory also, inserting phi is like a delta delta g, but that was from outside. So that's exactly what I have done. So now z phi, of course, I have already calculated. Okay, so if we now want to calculate, say g x1 to xn, which is minus I delta delta g x1 xn on z g, and then set g equal to 0. This can be thought of as, I have to write it there, I can write this as maybe I should again change this to M, or maybe I change this to capital N. That one is here. Okay, capital N point Green's function is not calculating. Divided by just this part. You have to divide by z of 0, right? This was z. Okay? Z of 0 is this evaluated at j equal to 0. Okay? So that's what I have written in the denominator. So the difference between the numerator and the denominator is that the numerator has some extra derivatives, denominator doesn't have that. Is this clear? And in fact, to simplify matter, I can just divide the numerator and the denominator by z phi of 0. It's the same, we are dividing by the same thing, right? Z phi of 0, you divide the numerator and the denominator. Okay, that doesn't change the result. But now you see that both the numerator and the denominator has the interpretation of being some appropriate correlation function with some integrals in the free theory. Okay? We, after all, how, what is the correlation function in the free theory, right? You start with z free of g over z free of 0 and take some derivative with respect to delta delta g's, and then eventually set j equal to 0. Okay? That's exactly what you are doing here. Okay? Except that the delta delta j are not just the ones that we had to begin with, the correlation functions that you want to calculate, but also from delta delta g is that come from interaction term, right? But the evaluation of this will be exactly identical to what we did in the free theory, right? Because this is exactly what we calculated in the free theory. Is that point clear? So whatever Feynman rules you have derived in free theory, okay, can be utilized. The fact that we have to insert this certain number of times, right, that can be encoded in some additional ingredient in the Feynman rule, right, which is that whenever there is an interaction, that for every power of lambda, we have the rule that we can insert an interaction vortex of this type, okay, which I'll call X. This can also form in W propagator. Right? And why I have taken 4? Because there are 4 of these, right? Each of those 4 has to form the end of a propagator. Right? Recall in the free field theory, what we saw is that for every delta delta j xi, right, that xi has to form the end of a propagator. Okay? Here you have 4 factors of delta delta jx. Right? Each of them will have to form the end of a propagator, that's why I have drawn it as 4 lines. Okay, so 1x with this kind of vortex is like 4 lines instead of 1 line. Okay, instead of end of 1 line, right? This can end on 4 different lines. Right? That's the only difference between these ends, right, that we consider there and this one. The other difference, of course, is that whenever you have something like this, you also have these factors, minus I lambda over 4 factorial, right, for every such vortex. If there are n of them, then you also have this 1 over n factorial, okay, that you have to take into account. And you have an integral over x. Yes.
Denominator
and yes, thank you. Power n. Because this can appear n times, right? So for every time you have this factor, right? So if there are n of these, then you will draw a diagram with n such vortices. You have to independently integrate over the coordinates of each of these, and the general idea is that you have to now draw all possible Feynman diagrams where the n's can be either these, n's of propagators can be either these or one of the X's that are there here. Is this point clear? So we'll work out some examples, then maybe it will become a little clearer. So let's suppose that you are trying to calculate gx1, x2, two vortices, two order lambda. Two order lambda means that you can use this kind of vortex either 0 times or 1 time. Okay? 0 times means that's the order lambda to the 0. Order lambda means you have to use it once. So lambda to the 0, let's look at that first. This is just this line. Then without using that vortex, we have the usual term that we had seen earlier. Order lambda means that we have to use this vortex once. But you also have these 2 points. Okay, let me draw them as x1 and x2. Okay. And somehow each of these points, each of these, as well as each of these 4 points, which are this vortex, must form some end of a propagator. Okay. So what are the possibilities? What can you do?
One loop.
Yeah, so one is like this. this. Yeah, this basically means what? Okay, we'll write down the result for this. Okay, but let's call this diagram A, diagram B. What is there anything else?
Join x1, x2
and
there will be a...
Yeah, so you can join x1, x2 and then you can use this. Okay. So let's now try to write down the expressions for each of these.
For calculating z, there is a denominator, there is a term, and I think for this term, this bubble diagram will cancel.
Yeah,
right?
But that we will see, we have to see later. You don't know offhand that it will cancel.
No, so, in time, when you write g, so
yes.
I don't think this one should write in, the sec, in lambda or at the second diagram.
No, you have to write.
Yeah, that will.
Well, yeah, okay, yes. So,
because.
Yeah, so you have to divide by something. That is true. I'll write a new denominator also, right?
Okay,
so
okay.
Let's call this a numerator. Okay. Yeah. So this is a numerator. Okay, I have to write a numerator also.
Okay.
Okay, so this one is easy, right? Delta x1, x2. So A just gives you delta x1, x2. B has minus I lambda over 4 factorial. Right? Because every there is one vortex like this, that's minus I lambda over 4 factorial. There is only one of them, so there is no 1 over n factorial, we don't have to bother about, right? Just one vortex. Let me write 1 over 1 factorial. Just one. Then you have an integral, d4x. And then, we have delta x1. X delta x to x and delta xx. This clear? Now it so happens that this is actually infinite. Okay, delta xx, if you remember the expression, this is I times the integral d 4 k over 2 pi to the 4, we had e to the I k dot x minus x, right? That's just 1, and denominator we have k squared plus minus I. So the poles of the denominator you don't have to worry about because of the I epsilon, right? But at large k, if you look at the integral at large k, right? Do it define a radial variable and an angular variable, right? This goes like k cube dk, right? Four dimensional integral, just like three dimensions, it goes r square dr, right? The volume integral that goes k cube dk, and in the denominator it draws as k square. Okay, so this is divergent from large k. Okay, but these divergences we'll worry about later. Okay, but there will be plenty of divergences that we'll see, so we'll not worry about this right now. Yeah, but this is the formal expression that we'll write for this diagram. Is this clear? Well, we have not finished yet. Okay. Because now we have to worry about what is called combinatorial factor, okay, which is how many ways you can get here. Okay. Now, we'll already use the fact that in free field theory, combinatorial factors are all trivial. Yeah, that you have already seen. As long as the j's are all distinguishable, they are combinatorial factors are all one, so you don't have to worry about anything that is coming from the free field theory by expanding that propagator. But nevertheless, there are other things which we have to worry about. So here you see, you have this x1 over here. Now, we had four factors of delta delta j coming from here. And this x1 has to pair with one of these delta delta j's, one of these four x's. But it could be any of those four. This combinatorial factor we didn't take into account while dealing with free field theory, because there, of course, each of them had carried different x's, right? So we have counted them differently anyway. Here, it, whether you attach it to the first x or the second x or third or the fourth, doesn't matter, so you have to count them separately, right? So that gives a factor of 4. Is that clear? Then the second one has 3 possible delta delta j's left over, so it has to adjust to one of those 3. So that gives a factor of 3. And then for the others, 2 that are left over, they have no choice, right? They have to pair with each other, right? So this is what you get. So this then gives you minus I lambda by 2 times this 4 factorial, and this cancels to give a factor of 2, e4x, delta xx, delta x2x, or x1x, x2x, and delta xx. So let's do C. We have them C. So again, we have minus I lambda over 4 factorial integral d4x. Okay, it's still 1 factorial because you have only 1 vertex. Then you have delta x1, x2. And then delta xx whole square. 2 factors of delta xx. And finally, the combinatorial factor. Anybody wants to try?
3.
Why 3?
Because one of the leg can go with another 3.
Yeah.
And then
the other two have to get fixed, right? So it's basically that you have 4 objects, right? In the field theory, the 4 objects should have been distinguished, right? And they would have counted how many ways, how many independent terms would you have counted? We saw 4 factorial, but they are not all independent, right?
Yeah.
The number of independent terms, if there are 4 distinct legs, right? You would have counted as 3, delta x1, x2, delta x3, x4, x1, x3, x2, x4, and x1, x4, x2, x3, right? All those are counted as the same this time, right? Because x1, x2, and x3, and x4 have been set equal, right? That's why you're getting this equal to square, but you get a factor of 3, because those 3 that you would have counted independently in the free theory now are counted as the same. So this is what you have to remember, right? That when you count these combinatorial factors, that you have to count things which would have been distinguished in the field theory if you think of the vortex factors differently, right? But which now are not distinguished, right? That's where these factors come from. So this gives you, you see that this is a factor of 1/8, right? This is minus I lambda by 8. D4x Okay, but now we have to look at the denominator. Let me remind you the denominator and the structure of sum over n equal to 0 to infinity 1 over n factorial. This was the denominator factor. I just divided explicitly by z phi of 0, both numerator and denominator, just so that it can be interpreted as a phi field correlation function.
Raised to the power n.
Raised to the power n. So the first term is 1. Right? N equal to 0 term. Because that's the z phi of 0 over z phi of 0. The second term onwards we can interpret as Feynman diagrams of the p-theory, right? So in what way does it differ from the one that you calculated in the numerator? The way it differs is that there are no external legs anymore, right? No analog of x1, x2, right? Only internal legs. So we have this factor. So let's calculate this. This is minus I lambda over 4 factorial. Integral d 4x delta x square. And the commutatorial factor is 3. Is the same counting that we did there. So it's 1 minus this. Now here you would notice that, okay, maybe if I write the numerator, it will become a little clearer. So the numerator, total contribution, numerator, can be written as 1, sorry, delta x1, x2 times 1 minus this. So I like that 1 plus this, 1 plus delta x1, x2 was there the 0th order diagram, and now you have a delta x1, x2 times this integral, right? That integral is this bubble plus some other diagrams. Which are which is this one. Okay. Now, because you are trying to calculate to order lambda, we can multiply this because this is of order lambda square term we are adding. Okay, so order, if you want to calculate to order lambda, we are not making an error by multiplying it by this. Okay? And then you see that this term just cancels this factor in the numerator. Is this point clear? Okay, this is only up to this order, right? I'm not claiming at this stage that this is a general result. Okay, although we'll prove that this is a general result. But at least up to order lambda, if you are trying to calculate. The effect of the denominator is basically to cancel off this piece. Right? Which means that you only include this diagram and this diagram, and not the ones with bubbles. With some disconnected piece, okay, which is disconnected from all external legs. There is another way of doing this, okay, which may be a little easier. Okay. That you take the numerator, okay, which is this, plus this in the numerator, and then you multiply it by 1 plus this inverse. That's the denominator, right? But this you can write to this order as 1 minus this. Because the other terms are higher order, right? Order lambda square. And then you take the product of this with this. So you get delta x1 x2 plus delta x1 x2 times this plus this, and then this minus this, the only term that is relevant is how to take the product to delta, because others are of higher order. Okay, so minus delta x1 x2 times this, and this is 0. Not 0, this is these two terms cancel. So it's just delta x1 x2 plus this. Okay, this will turn out to be a general result, but that's not something we have to. Okay, this, just in this example, we see that there is a cancellation. Right? So it's as if you can only consider diagrams which have no piece which is not connected to any of the external lines. Is that okay? So let's try to do some other diagrams. Okay, four-point function now. So you have to calculate to order lambda. So there are usual diagrams x1, x2, x3, x4. These are the zeroth order. This is lambda to 0. Then order lambda, we have this. Or we have this times each of these can be accompanied by the bubble. But those will again cancel with the denominator. Okay, you can see that this can again be thought of as this times 1 plus the bubble. Yeah, and then 1 plus the bubble in the denominator will just cancel this one. Okay. So that again basically is a reflection of the fact that the bubble diagrams, the bubbles are those which are not connected to any external line. Right? Those can simply be ignored. Where the denominator basically cancels those. But let's focus on this one. Okay, so these we have already calculated, right? Free field theory result. So this is the non-trivial one. This is the interacting theory. So we have minus I lambda over 4 factorial. Then integral d4 x. And then you have delta x1 x delta x2 x. And then the combinatorial factors, right? So the combinatorial factors are the first line can go into any four, right? So it's basically four factorial. The first line can go into any four. Second one can go to three, and then two and one. Times four, times three, times two, times one. Is that clear? Okay, so you see that this cancels this 4 factorial. Okay, so this is the expression for that diagram. Okay. So in evaluating Feynman diagrams, there are two steps that you have to be careful. One is that you have to make sure that you have drawn all diagrams. Okay. And the second is that you have to make sure that you have counted the combinatorial factors correctly. Okay, then once you have done these two, then you just evaluate each Feynman diagram, add up their contribution, and that gives a result to that order.
There will be other diagrams.
There will be?
Other diagrams in this case also.
There are these, right? And yes, are the other diagrams, yes, you are right. So there will be things like these. Right? Yeah. So okay, let's just do this counting. X1, X2, X3, X4. So this is not cancelled by anything else. Wait, this is not cancelled by the bubble, right? Because this is, even though they are disconnected, right? This is not disconnected from the rest. So this will be integral, again, minus I lambda by 4 factorial. 4 factorial. Integral d4x. Then you have delta x1, x2. Delta x3 x, delta x4 x, and delta xx. Times you have to calculate the combinatorial factor. So x1 goes with x2, right? There's a choice over there. This x3 could go into any of the four x's which are here, right? That gives a 4. Then x4 could go into 3 that are left over. After that, the 2 are left over, they are paired, right? There is no choice over there. So net, you get a factor of half. Is this point clear? So what I'll do now is that I'll do another diagram, which is of order lambda squared. Okay, here I'll not try to write all the diagrams. Okay, but just pick one diagram and see what its contribution is. So you consider, say, this diagram. So this is a contribution to the four quadrants function, right? There are four external lines. Okay, so x1, x2, x3, x4. Okay, let's call this x and y. So what are the factors that we'll get here? Let's start writing them down.
Square lambda square.
Minus I lambda over 4 factorial.
Square.
The 1 by 2 factorial, right? Mm-hmm. Because there are two of them. Mm-hmm. Then you have integral d4x d4y. D4y. Mm-hmm. D4y. And then you have to write the deltas. Okay, so delta x1 x delta x2 x delta x3 y delta x4 y and then delta x y, but that comes to x. Anything else we need here? The combinatorial factors, right? So what is the combinatorial factor here? Let's start with x1. X1 can go to 8, not 4 actually, because the 4 from here and 4 from here, right? These two vertices have not been distinguished. They're the same, they'll give the same diagonal, right? So x1 can go to 8. Given this, x2 can go to 3. X3 can go to 4. Right? This one still has 4 left over. So that's 4. X4 can go to 3. And anything else is needed? Yeah, because there are 2 from here, 2 from here, right? So they have to decide after which one pairs with what, right? So that's 2 different ways. So that gives you 2.
Why first 3 comes?
Okay. So x1 can go to any of these 8, right? These 4 or these 4, right? Suppose x1 is already attached to this one. Then x2 still has 3 more lines from coming out from here which it can attach to, right? Well, it depends on how you count. I mean, you can count in different orders. If x2 connects to these, that will be a different diagram, right? Because that will be a diagram where x1 and x2 are connected to different vortex, right? That will draw as a separate diagram. Because its contribution is not the same as this one. Yeah, so that's how, for this diagram, once x1 is connected here, x2 also has to connect here. Okay, so you have to make sure that when you count combinatorial factors, you have to look at the number of inequivalent, the same diagram, right? How many ways it can appear. So if it's a different diagram, then you of course have a different expression anyway, right? So you don't count those in a combinatorial factor. Is this point clear? So this gives a net factor of half, right? Because I think this is 4 factorial times 4 factorial, so it gives a factor of half. Okay, so next time we will prove first this factorization of the bubble diagram. And the main issue there will be the following, right? That I think just pictorially it is clear that if you take any connected diagram which doesn't have a bubble, and any bubble diagram, put them together, that's also a possible Feynman diagram. There's no doubt about that, right? You can always draw a Feynman diagram, which is some diagram times a bubble. Okay. So in that sense, if you take the product of connected, not connected, the diagrams without bubbles, okay, times 1 plus a diagram with bubbles, right, they will generate all possible diagrams. Is that point clear? You take a factor which is diagram without bubbles, okay, times 1 plus diagram with bubbles. If you take the product, right, you will generate all possible diagrams. The issue is whether the combinatorial factor of those diagrams are such that it can be factored. See, it is not enough to show that the diagram by diagram they match, right? Of course, it is true that given any diagram, right? If I take, for example, a diagram like this, which say has some diagram like this, times a complicated diagram here like this. This is a possible Feynman diagram, right? That is, there's no doubt about that. This diagram is there. On the other hand, if we just take the sum of all diagrams, okay, sum of diagrams like this plus various other things 1 plus various other things times this. Suppose you take the product. Okay. There is one term in the product which will be this one. Okay. So naively you would think that okay, indeed this factorized thing should capture everything. Right? Because the factorized thing has all diagrams. Right? This has no bubbles, but this has 1 plus all bubbles. So to take a product, all diagrams will be reproduced.
But the coefficient.
Yeah. The question is the coefficient, we have to make sure that they are the same. Right? See, this comes with a specific coefficient, right? For example, this is a diagram of order, let's say, 1, 2, 3 powers of lambda, right? So it has a 1 over 3 factorial times something. Right? This is like 1 over 2 factorial times something, right? Because it has 2 powers of lambda. This diagram has how many orders? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right? So this starts with 1 over 5 factorial. Right? So you have to make sure that these 5 factorial somehow there is other combinatorial factors makes this 1 over 5 factorial into 1 over 2 factorial. 3 factorial times 1 over 2 factorial. Right? If you can do that, then you have proved that the diagram factorizes. Right? And then this is just cancelled by what you had in the denominator. Right? That is, this is something what you will check the next time. That in general, there is a factorization of the combinatorial factors which allows us to write. Us to write this
one.
Then that will cancel.
So in this expansion you have just single bubble diagram, so product of bubbles also can be there. Right?
Yes, you can have product of bubbles also.
Instead of all bubbles.
Instead of all bubbles. Okay? But they cancel anyway. Okay, so it doesn't really matter if you have product of bubbles also in this. Said, but yes, indeed you have product of bubbles because here also you can have product of bubbles, right? There is nothing which prevents us from drawing a diagram like this. So all of those will cancel. I mean, one can further show that that this can be written as exponential of something which doesn't have product of bubbles, but that's irrelevant because it will cancel out anywhere at the end. Right? So if it can be written as exponential or something nice or not, doesn't really matter very much.
Yeah, but that will give the vacuum transition energy. Means if you want to calculate the vacuum energy, that exponential factor will contribute it.
Well, the point is vacuum energy is infinite anyway, right? So you don't calculate it that way. I mean, there are so many normalization factors that we are ignoring here.
Yeah, but actually, right. Yeah, in 4 dimension that is true, but in lower dimension, if one want to get the vacuum.
Well, vacuum energy is divergent in all dimensions somehow. So, yeah, it's
okay.
Even in 2 dimensions, right? If you look at the vacuum energy, it will be divergent. Except in quantum mechanics, right, where you can calculate the harmonic oscillator. If you have a single harmonic oscillator, right, if the ground state energy is non-zero, otherwise it will be divergent. You think of a one-dimensional oscillator, right? If you add this half, which is the ground state energy of one harmonic oscillator, right? If there are infinite number of harmonic oscillators,
yeah.
That half h bar omega, if you add up, you'll get divergent result, right?
Yes, that's true.
So sometimes this can be useful when you are trying to do, things in a background. Where suppose you have switched on a background, you want to say how much the energy changes when you switch on some background, then. You're writing things in terms of bubble diagrams may be useful, but just for conventional perturbation theory, right, these things just be factored out. So tomorrow there will be no class. We'll have the class on Friday. Next week I may have to reschedule some of the classes, but I'll write to you by email.